there is no way to take our foot off the accelerator now, because the world is accelerating, as we know. So it's just now go, go, go. We're in the fast lane, whether we like it or not. I had a dream last night, and two people were walking by talking. They turned around, looked at this car, and said, "Whoa, look at that car." And they're talking like just so amazed. And they said, "Who's that car?" And I looked and I said, "Oh, that's my car. That's my car." And then I looked, I had this cell phone or some sort of communication device in my hand also. And the car was the coolest looking car you've ever seen, and it was the most beautiful blue anyone's ever seen, I'm telling you. It was just the most awesome car. And so was the communication device. I mean, everything was just like, wow. And I realized, that's my car. And then I told him, yeah, my boss gave it to me. My boss gave me this car. Hey, it's getting very interesting right now. As I was concerned about Greece is not going to pay their debt and all hell is breaking loose, it's going to be a wild ride around the world right now. Cosmic corporate culture has given up any pretense of being anything other than absolute tyrants. Whatever anyone thinks about Donald Trump, he stood up and spoke what was on many people's minds, saying, "Hey, you know, we don't know who's coming into this country." NBC, you know, fired him. Fired him. The mainstream media says, "You can't shift the narrative. You got to say what we want you to say." The global narrative is a cosmic corporate culture narrative right now. And if you, even billionaires, if they speak, go off script, off with their heads, off with their heads. The only thing about me is that I work for Jesus, so they have to go to Jesus to fire me. They can petition Jesus all they want, okay? And I'm not the slightest bit worried that Jesus is going to fire me. You see, how about working for that kind of boss? How would you like to work for that kind of boss? The best boss ever. He's the boss that gave me this car. And we're gonna. And I believe he just wants me to drive that car around, so to speak. It's a dream symbol, and just let people see it, and they're just gonna go, "Wow, what kind of car is that? That is awesome." So yeah, I mean, petition all you like, whoever world, you know, petition Jesus all you like. And you don't, you know, you can't go petition the Pope, the President, whatever. I've excommunicated the Pope, and President doesn't matter. And, you know, this doesn't matter what anybody in the world says. If you want to get me fired, you got to go to Jesus and tell Jesus to fire me. I'm happy. Go ahead and talk to him and get me fired if you can. Otherwise, I'm going to keep on driving the car around. And speak, you know, I was speaking that I'm in the apostolic tradition of Christianity, having been meeting directly with Jesus and experiencing that. That's what an apostle is, and agreeing with it. And I've given all Christians permission to be quiet, be still, be quiet, and feel the wow. Have total permission. See, with the apostolic authority, I give all Christians permission. But then I realized today, you know what? I also have some authority in Buddhism, having met with Longchenpa. That gives me a certain transmissional authority in Buddhism too. So if you happen to be Buddhist, I give you absolute permission to be quiet, to be still, for as long as you want, to do absolutely nothing, and to fully resonate in the wow of the now. Okay, absolutely, you have permission for that. Same with Hinduism at Vedanta. Ramana Maharshi, I've met with Ramana Maharshi, and have got the full feeling of what he's about. And so there is some transmissional authority there. If you happen to be Hindu, you happen to be non-dualist, Vedantist, whatever, you have my full permission to just be quiet and be still and just full stop in the wow. And if you happen to be other sort of, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But I give everyone who wants to hear it permission, no matter what. But I'm just saying that I do have some authority, to do this. And that's what people are looking for now. Now, why is this important? Because cosmic corporate culture, and I use that term, meaning that this, the authority on this planet that is social engineering this planet, doesn't come only from this planet. It comes from places beyond this planet. If you're in the know, you realize that there are entities and civilizations all over this cosmos. And they form confederations. There's one, the large confederation here I call the cosmic corporate culture, that is taking over this planet and incorporating this planet. And they're working through the big global multinational corporations, the big media corporations, the banking, on and on and on. They are shaping the narrative, and they're telling us what we can say and what we can't say. And if we get off script, you say, "Oh man, look what happens to these people." And the news like just holds them up like posters. This is what happens to you if you go off script. So, people are paralyzed right now. This is what I found. What happened to the free-flowingness of the 60s, the 50s, the 60s, the 70s, and people saying, expressing what they felt, and it was okay. In fact, it was more than okay. You were supposed to do this. This is your not only your right, but your obligation to stand up to the man, to the authority, But the man has largely been replaced with the woman now. They replace the pants with the skirts. But and you can't you say, well, you can't stand up to them. That's not nice. That's not fair. It's a war against women or something. That's the corporations are hiding behind this facade of this lipstick facade, lipstick culture. They're hiding behind that facade, and through that facade, they are manipulating global culture and paralyzing us, so that we feel we don't feel that we have the authority to go quiet, go still, step back, and then allow. And when we step back, the light comes forward. You see, it envelops the entire universe. You could say it's a shifting universes, actually. We don't feel we have the authority to do this. And then when you have religious authorities, just a minute. When you have religious authorities who are going along with corporate culture, then you that really undermines you, which is what's happening, what I said with the Pope, and to some extent in other ways, like the Dalai Lama, who he still says a lot of good stuff, but to some extent he's quite political and is not quite for my. From what I see, delivering the juice, that we need, that the message that the world really, the spiritual message of the world really needs to hear. You absolutely have the right and permission to go still, to go quiet right now, and absolutely forget about the world altogether. There's absolutely nothing you have to do to shift universes. Okay, there's nothing you have to do whatsoever. So where's the juice coming from in this world? People are just like intimidated. This is why there's nothing happening. I keep thinking, where's the revival? It's not happening. And I don't think people even realize how intimidated and paralyzed they are. It's just kind of like deep down there's a feeling like, maybe I'm blowing it, but on the surface, we're just like basically automatons at this point. So, those who can need to step forward and say, "Hey, I'm giving you absolute permission, and I have, higher authority than cosmic corporate culture for sure." And if cosmic corporate culture doesn't like it, then go talk to Jesus and complain about it. File a complaint with Jesus, okay? That's fine. Complain all you want, petition all you want, do whatever you want. But Jesus has a way higher authority than cosmic corporate culture. So when Jesus gives you authority through apostles saying, hey, you have the right to go still, to go quiet, to shift universes, you don't have to do anything to shift universes. Yeah, there's nothing you have to prove to God whatsoever. You don't have to prove illusions are false because they never were true in the first place. And they're all always zero in the first place, and always zero. There's no truth or arrogance whatsoever. So we don't have to prove arrogance is wrong. We just have to let go of it. So from whatever tradition you are, if you're willing to accept it, the permission, accept the permission. We need someone to tell us, hey, it's okay, I'm giving you permission. You know, it's just like we think we're all grown up and we think we're all thinking of ourselves. No, we're not. We're under the spell of a big mother, as I call it. Big mother and big father, which is the cosmic corporate culture. And they have supreme confidence that they can control us. Supreme confidence. And as we're seeing now, I think they're banning all pretense at fairness whatsoever. I mean, it's just stunning that a presidential candidate cannot speak out on the issues without you know, the guillotine coming down on him from a corporation. You know, you cannot say what you want to say. But this is just all over like this. It's just all over now. So we think that we're mature. We think we're spiritual, etc. No, we are petrified. We are petrified here. And it takes a constant effort on my part just to keep them freezing up. Just to keep them freezing up from being intimidated. Just walking around this world is super intimidating right now. It's just, and I thought, stupid me, I thought that music could get me through this lifetime. I didn't count on the ferocity of cosmic corporate culture. I knew there would be a problem, but I thought music can overcome it. No, it can't. We have to have much stronger tools. Unfortunately, we have those tools now. The spiritual practice has been introduced here, walking together in the wow, is we have these assertions. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect unfairness. Cosmic corporate culture wants to say, well, you're unfair, which of course they use the skirts, the lipstick, lipstick culture to run interference for them and say, oh, you criticize me, how unfair, it's not fair, you're attacking me, you're making me feel uncomfortable, you know, it's unfair. I say, well, you know, you're saying that I'm unfair? Well, no, I'm perfectly unfair, actually. I'm taking refuge in, I am that perfect unfairness. I'm not saying I'm unfair. I'm saying I am that perfect unfairness. I'm absolutely that perfect unfairness, and you have the right to say that, because they will use this fairness thing to manipulate you and make you feel guilty, like, how dare you criticize us? How dare you vet us? How dare you, you know, say anything other than what we tell you to say? It's unfair if you do that. You can't go off script. That's unfair to us. We have the right to completely control you and insist that the dream controls the dreamer. And we say, well, you know what? Guess what? Who you're dealing with? I am that perfect unfairness. Can't get any more unfair. You know, checkmate. I am that perfect unfairness. So start saying this. I am that perfect unfairness. Yes, I am that perfect failure. They'll say, you're going to be a failure. What a failure you are. Say, yes, I am that perfect failure. I perfectly fail and always will from straying from what I am. I cannot stray from what I am. I'm a perfect failure in that. I am a perfect failure in that. I am that perfect failure. Okay. Now the music wasn't enough, and that was my, you know, big mistake. I came in here, I knew I wasn't supposed to get back into music. It wasn't going to be enough. The Holy Spirit told me, and I still fell for it. It was the 60s. I've been going back last couple of days listening to some songs from the 60s and you know, the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and the, you know, the 50s too, the late 50s. The music was so awesome that I don't know how anyone could not, you know, fall under its spell. You know, it is just, You can't even compare. I went back and listened to the song by the Mamas and Papas today, and just this evening, in 1966. I can't remember the name of the song right now. It'll pop in my mind. And I say, you can't touch that. I mean, it still sounds as good as the day I first heard it when I was 10 years old. And you're hearing the Mamas and Papas when you're 10 years old with the Wrecking Crew and the recording that they had. They had the studios with the, probably it might have been, Great Western Studios or something like that. It still sounds fabulous. And then there's so much great movie. I listen to the Beach Boys, you know, fabulous. Then if you want to shift to decades, you might listen to the Eagles, you know. It's fabulous. There's just so much music from that late 50s, late 60s, 70s, maybe 30 year span. 30 years. And we just absolutely, I completely, what do you say, just fell, just hung out with that music, just floated in that music for those 30 years. Just constantly. We were surrounded by music, constantly. Records, radio, concerts, radio in the car, radio at home, stereo at home, LPs, and then they went to 8-track, and then they went to cassette decks, and ultimately, you know, CDs, but we always had music going on. It never stopped. The music never stopped. The music never stopped. And it was just awesome music, and it still is. You just go back and listen to it, just say, wow. But my life has been an absolute wreck, a ruin, because cosmic corporate culture was absolutely taking over, and you could feel it, and you could feel like, whoa, this is scary. What's going on in this world? I feel the future is going to get really terrible. And what do we do about it? Listen to some more music. Listen to some more music. That didn't work. Didn't work. So we have to get beyond this. You know, I think my generation, the generations, you know, the boomers, and then the ones just after the boomers, and the ones that really grew up with this music, they think, you know, we're so cool. We got this great music. Nobody has as good a music as this, and that, you know, that's very true. It's very true. I think it's the best musical period in history, without question. Without question. You can just dial in so much stuff. It's ridiculous. And it's all on YouTube, which is the amazing thing. But it's not good enough. And people don't realize that their spirituality, their potential, their spiritual potential has been pushed off into a corner. Pushed off into a corner. And so it's very important that you just you have a moment where you just feel like, hey, you know what? I think it's time to get back to that. And I can do better. I can do better. I can do better. I need to do better. I don't have to succumb. I don't have to succumb. But the music is not going to free me. Okay, music's not going to free me. And I used to believe that, being a musician in a previous life, and maybe lives, you know, plural, and then this life again. And I thought, yeah, music is the answer. It's not. It's not at all the answer. Not even remotely the answer. And those big bad boys and girls who have come in here and incorporated this planet know how to use music to enslave us, don't they? They're very nasty. They play hardball for sure. Well, guess what? We're the Hall of Famers, and when it comes to playing hardball, nobody plays hardball like we do. We're that perfect unfairness. Absolutely, we are absolutely perfectly unfair. Nobody can be more unfair than we are. Yeah, and that's just the way it is. Yeah, we embrace that. Yes, I am perfectly unfair. I am perfectly unfair. Absolutely. Yes, I am perfectly unfair. See, I can't stray at all from what I am. And if you call that unfair, so be it. Therefore, I am that perfect unfairness. Own it. I am that perfect unfairness. Because from the standpoint of the ego, that's how they're going to see it. And if you don't own it, they're going to make you feel guilty about it. See, this is why making these negative assertions and owning it is so powerful. It is more powerful than music. You know, cosmic corporate culture says, you got to do what we say. What are you going to do? You know, sing a Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young you song or something. You who are on the road must have a code that you can live by. They're going to say, you know, doesn't, so what? You know, you're unfair. This is unfair. And you can't be unfair. You're being unfair to our lovely ladies who are telling you what to do, telling you what we want you to do. And you can't be unfair to the lovely ladies. So, you know, the songs don't work. But we can say, well, yeah, that is absolutely right. In fact, actually, you're not quite right at all. I am that perfect unfairness. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I am that perfect unfairness. So when you get a dream like this one, it means something. It means something. This is the vehicle. You know, the boss gave me a new vehicle, and that vehicle is, as we would say back in the day, that vehicle is primo. Is primo. And I've never seen anything like it. It was just beautiful, and. I said, well, yeah, I'll drive that car. I own it. I claimed it. You know, I didn't say, I don't know whose car that is. Yeah, it's nice. No, I said, no, that is my car. That's my car. That's my car. My boss gave it to me. And yeah, I'm going to own it. So own it. You got to own your spirituality. If you give your spirituality up to cosmic corporate culture, you're going to end up like the millennials are ending up. Okay. Some of them, a lot of them, we pray that they don't, that they, you know, shed their spell, the spell that they're under, for sure. You've got to own your spirituality. You do not let cosmic corporate culture own your spirituality. You don't let the goddess own your spirituality, okay, either. That's the same thing, really. Cosmic corporate culture is just a front for the goddess, who is the one that invites you to dance in this universe of electromagnetic light, electromagnetic energy. The invitation to dance, that is the invitation to dream, a dream of arrogance, actually. And you have to say no to that. You know, you cannot let the goddess own your spirituality. You cannot allow cosmic corporate culture to own your spirituality. You have to own it, okay? You're the sovereign of the dream. You're the sovereign. You have to own it. So we say, yes, yes, I am that perfect unfairness. So no one can make you feel guilty about it. Say, I celebrate my perfect unfairness. I absolutely celebrate it. I absolutely celebrate it. Because I cannot stray from what I am. I cannot stray from what God created me as. I am that perfect unfairness. Yes, 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 I am that perfect unfairness. Yes, 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 I am that perfect failure. They're going to say, you know, oh, you're just going to be a total failure. I say, no. Yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. I am that total, complete, flawless, immaculate, perfect failure forever and ever and ever. Yes, I am that. Yes, I am that. Okay. Own it. Own it. Own it. Because what it means is you cannot stray from what you are. And from the standpoint of this dream, this electromagnetic universe, and the goddess and cosmic corporate culture who's telling you this is your home, this you must, you know, you must make prove that arrogance isn't arrogant. From their standpoint, you know, you're terrible. You're absolutely terrible. Your true spirituality is an anathema. It's horrible. They hate it. And they say, you're such a failure. I say, no, actually, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. Yes, yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am that perfect failure. And they say, you're going to be cast into darkness and annihilated. And say, yes, I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect darkness. Meaning, I am that darkness that delusion and illusion cannot penetrate at all. The false light cannot even enter this darkness. Cannot cast any shadows upon this perfect light. Actually, light. That actually I am, this perfect light. But from their standpoint, it's perfect, it's darkness, it's horrible darkness. You're horribly dark. What a horrible, wretched, dark mind you have. Say, yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I am that perfect darkness. Own it. Own your spirituality. And of course, from the standpoint of this universe, your spirituality is a horrible, wretched thing. It's something to, you know, it's like the most hideous refuse you could possibly imagine, according to this universe. And how dare you, you know, look at that stinky, rotting, horrible, you know, dark stuff. You recoil from it, but we don't recoil from it. We absolutely embrace it and own it. We say, yes, I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. I am that perfect instability. They say, you're so unstable. I am that perfect instability. I'm perfectly unstable. What does that mean? I'm perfectly unstable. It means I cannot take a stable step away from what I am at all. There's no way I can have any stability whatsoever in that. None. Zero. Zero. I have perfect instability. I am indeed perfectly unfair. I am that perfect unfairness. And I am that perfect untouchableness. Untouchability. Untouchability. They say, we just can't get through to you. I say, well, that's because I'm perfectly I am that perfect untouchability. I am that perfect untouchability. I am that perfect untouchableness. Cannot be touched by the universe. I cannot be even touched at all. In other words, the notion of straying from what I am can never touch me at all. The dream of straying from what I am can never touch me at all. So, as of right now, there's not many people watching these videos and hearing this. It's understandable that people are under a spell. They're intimidated, very intimidated. And I don't blame or judge anybody for that, because if I weren't doing this 24/7, I would be in the same situation for sure. It's just overwhelmingly intimidating, especially for younger generations, these generations that are somewhat, who grew up with technology, who grew up with are children of cosmic corporate culture. You might see CCCC, the four C's, cosmic corporate culture children is what they are. And so they don't have any reference point whatsoever, whereas I have reference points that go back not only my generation, but my parents' generation and my grandparents' generation. And that stretches back to the full century of the 20th century. Spiritual going back again, you know, more than 100 years as far as spiritual traditions in this world. And so I have reference, have been able to reference points. We say, you know, hey, this situation we're in now is horrible, absolutely horrible. People have trying to surrender their spirituality and say, oh yeah, my spirituality is what my smartphone tells me it is. And it's way smarter than I am. It's got a nice female voice on it who's telling me what my spirituality is. And you say, oh, thank you, Big Mother. I'm so happy that you know what to tell me, because I'm an idiot and I don't know what I am at all. You know, like that. Well, you know, that's just sheer intimidation. That's all it is. Sheer fear, intimidation, paralysis, spiritual paralysis. So, but we can reclaim our spirituality from this. There's nothing really stopping us at all. And what we need is authority greater than cosmic corporate culture, greater than the goddess, to say, yes, you can. I give you full permission. And if the goddess doesn't like it, tell her to take it up with Jesus, okay? Tell her to take it up with Jesus. Go say, hey, goddess, you don't like this? Well, tough. Go take it up with Jesus. And argue with him. Don't argue with me. I'm not interested in your arguments or your discussions. I'm not interested in discussing it with you, goddess, at all. Okay. If you want discussion, you go talk to Jesus. All right. Just say that. Just go talk to Jesus. You have my full permission to say that. See, I'm not discussing anything with the ego, with cosmic corporate culture, with lipstick culture, with the goddess. I'm not discussing anything at all. I'm just being quiet. I'm being still. I am saying, yes, I am that perfect darkness. I am that. I am that perfect unfairness. I am that perfect unfairness. Yeah, completely unfair to the ego. Absolutely, I am. And relish that and feel it and say, this is great. I love this. I love this. I love this. And cosmic corporate culture, of course, is going to cry. The goddess will be crying so many tears. I say, hey, you want to go? Don't cry to me. Go cry to Jesus. I'm perfectly unfair. I am that perfect unfairness. So you can't get anywhere with me. You know, that's just how God created me. Nothing I can do about it. You want to think you can change that? Go talk to my boss. Go talk to my boss and see if you can get anywhere there. Because I don't got any. I can't have any authority. I can't change what I am. Of course, Jesus can't change what he is either. But you kick her upstairs and let her go cry to Jesus and wail and complain and try to sweet talk Jesus. Go, you know, don't be afraid of that at all. Don't be afraid of that. Rest in that. That is the kind of confidence I have in Jesus. Okay, I don't have to protect Jesus from the goddess. I say, goddess, I am that perfect unfairness. So. Can't just unchange it. I'm that perfect darkness. I'm that perfect, you know, failure. I'm that perfect failure. I am that perfect failure. So, nothing I can do for you. You go talk to Jesus, all right? And you know, you have to have that kind of confidence in Jesus that the goddess is not going to get anywhere with them. But of course, she says, no. I don't want to go talk with Jesus because if I'll convince him and then it'll really be bad for you. So I'll make you a side deal. I won't even involve Jesus. I won't tell Jesus how bad you are. But we and you will make a deal, you know, and I won't tell Jesus. That's the goddess's little trick, okay? The ego goddess trick. Okay, this is the trick we must bring to light, and we're bringing this to light. We get intimidated. We think, wow. The goddess says, I did something terrible. I'm totally unfair. It's horribly unfair. Guilty, bad. And she says she's going to go talk to Jesus about it. And Jesus might cut me off. You know, he's going to say, oh, really? You hurt the goddess's feelings? That's terrible. And I don't want that. I'll lose my connection to spirit or something. And the goddess says, well, I'll tell you what you did is really bad, but I got a lot of compassion. I'm a goddess of compassion and mercy. So, I'm not going to go talk to Jesus about it, but I am going to talk with you, and I am going to tell you that this is what you have to do to make it right. So, and if you ever screw up, I'm going to go talk to Jesus. So she holds this blackmail over you for your whole life. Your whole life, you can be blackmailed. Most people are blackmailed their entire life by the ego, the goddess, same thing, and they're afraid that the goddess is going to go to Jesus and rat on you, you know. So you co-opt this whole situation and say, hey, goddess, I want you to go talk to Jesus about me. Don't bother me with anything. I can't change. I'm a perfect failure. I absolutely want you to talk to Jesus. I want you to tell Jesus how absolutely terrible I am, what a perfect failure I am, what perfect darkness I am, how perfectly dark I am, how perfectly unfair I am, how completely unstable I am. I want you to go tell Jesus these things. Okay. Absolutely. In fact, I want you to do it right now. I want you to do it right now. I don't want you to spend one more instant trying to cut a deal with me. I want you to go tell Jesus this right now, this instant. See, this is the attitude that we have to have. This is the winning attitude. This very instant. Don't even give the goddess an even one instant. Say, well, you know, maybe I'll give you one more instant to talk about the deal. No, go this very instant, this very instant, this very instant, this very instant. And please tell Jesus how absolutely terrible I am. I'm perfectly terrible. I'm perfectly unfair, perfectly unjust. I'm perfectly discriminatory. Yeah, I am that perfect discrimination. Yeah, I am that perfect bigot. I am that perfect unfairness. I am that perfect terribleness. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect failure. And on and on and on. On and on and on. I want you to go and tell Jesus that right now. In fact, I insist upon it. I insist upon it. Because it's only fair to you. Since I'm that perfect unfairness, it'll be fair to you. Go talk to my boss about it. Because I can't do anything for you. I'm still exactly as God created me. I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created spirit to be. Okay? I'm exactly that. I'm exactly that. I'm exactly that. And so this is the attitude you must have with ego. By all means, go to the boss and tell me that I'm the worst person that's ever been, and I should be tortured forever. Go tell Jesus that right this instant. So you need to have that kind of confidence in Jesus, okay? This is what you need, and this is what I have, and this is what's helpful. And I have to express it. I have to express it in the world. That's the next step. More fully. I'm expressing it right here, but I more fully express this. This is what helps. This is what helps. When your spirit starts hearing this, you will say, hey, what is this? Hey, what is this? Let me see if I can dial up a graphic here. Maybe not. It's not going to go. What is this? You'll say, what is this? What is this? What is this? What in the world? And then you'll say, hey, you know what? I kind of like this. I kind of like this. And this is different. This is different. Oh, I can dial up a graphic here. You'll say, this is different. And you say, so here we go. I am that perfect failure. I am that perfect darkness. I am that perfect instability. I am that perfect untouchability. I am that perfect unfairness. Make this your mantra, okay? You have full permission. You have my full permission, apostolic permission, Buddha mind transmission permission, you know, non-dual permission, okay? To say this, I am that, yes, I am that perfect failure, I am that perfect darkness, I am that perfect instability, I am that perfect untouchability, I am that perfect unfairness. You can say, I am that perfect discrimination. Yeah, God created me completely as a completely discriminatory. I'm totally discriminatory. And that is, I can't choose to be anything other than what I am. Yeah, I can't choose to be anything. I can say, I'm that total idiot, too. I'm that perfect idiot. Yeah, I'm that perfect idiot. Because I cannot even conceive of anything other than what I am. Yeah, I am that perfect idiot. Go tell Jesus I'm a perfect idiot. Please, as fast as you can. He needs to know. He really needs to know. You know? He's got to know. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. Go tell Jesus. Hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. He's got to know this. He's got to know this. He's got to know this. And maybe he'll send me a postcard, you know, from your brother Jesus. Send me a postcard. This is the attitude, and so don't try to make illusions true, so then you can prove them false. Great advice, he'll say that, he'll tell us that, but the attitude is this attitude. Yes, please go tell Jesus, I'm perfectly terrible, I'm perfect idiot, I'm a perfect idiot, I'm a perfect failure, I am that perfect unfairness. Tell him right now, tell him, and tell him again. I want him to hear it right now, I want him to know it. Inform him this instant. Inform him. So this is the attitude that we need to have. And what does Jesus do in return? He gives us this car. You know, he gives us communication devices. Like, that's his answer. He says, wow, my brother is this way. Really? Well, maybe I better help him out and give him something really nice then. He must be kind of feeling bad about himself or something, you know. It's like, oh, you know, the goddess doesn't like him. Well, great. Let me give him a card and let me help him out, spread the good news, you know, so I can get others to go tell me about, you know, how completely unfair. And of course, this is music to Jesus' ears. The goddess tells him how terrible we are, and he goes, wow, that's great. I love that. That's wonderful. My message is finally getting through. I don't need to do anything to change this dream at all. I'm the sovereign over this dream. No dream figures that I'm dreaming have any any power over me whatsoever. They can't make me feel guilty or wrong or unfair or say I'm stupid or change this or blah, 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 blah. So Jesus is applauding. He's like, message is finally getting through. This is tremendous. I love it. I love it. I love it. So give Jesus a gift. The best gift you can have is send the goddess to him right this instant and tell her to absolutely condemn me in the most strongest terms she could possibly condemn me as right now, and keep that condemnation going as long as she can. And Jesus will say, thank you, thank you, thank you, brother, thank you. This is music to my ears. I love it. I love it. So give Jesus a gift. I mean, he's done so much for us, right? Give him a gift. That's all. He's waiting for this gift. He's waiting for this gift. He let the ego go condemn us. Absolutely. To Jesus, he said, I would love to hear that condemnation. Yeah, absolutely right. Yeah, my brother is. You say, yeah, my brother is totally unjust, isn't he? He can't stray one bit from how God created him, can he? Absolutely. That is so true. That is so true. That is so true. So, the attitude of the world as we're feeling it now, you can feel there's a different attitude here than what you're hearing on the news, in culture, etc., right? It's a totally different attitude, all right? And this is what we need to, A, B, these attitudes. Say, hey, wait a minute, there's this attitude here, and there's attitude over there. There's a quite different, you know, what's going on here? Why is there such a huge difference here? And you might start saying, well, wait a minute, what's happened to me? And it's better late than never. It's better late than never. Everybody's terrified. Everyone I talk to is terrified. We speak in hushed tones, like, the, you know, like we're some criminals that if anyone hears us talking, we'll be arrested immediately. That is true. That is true. Yeah. Hey, you know, what do you think of this thing? Yeah. Yeah, I kind of think, I always say, don't get me wrong. This is how they say it to me. Like, don't get me wrong. I don't want you to think I'm like this. I'm really not like this. And I don't want you to think that I'm trying to be like that. But, you know, the situation really sucks. I mean, it's absolutely, then they start talking, you know. But they want to be sure that you don't take it wrong, you know, like, you don't, meaning you don't say, hey, you know what he said or she said, you know, it's like, oh, no, 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 no. So people are living in absolute fear right now of cosmic corporate culture. We don't have, the America that used to be is absolutely a thing of the past. However, in that it was an expression of at least a little bit of freedom that we were feeling. That freedom is still within us. And it can be reborn. It's not totally dead. I have this orange tree that put in a pot, and we thought we put it in a good place, but it wasn't a good place. It wasn't thriving, no matter. And we finally, it just was so sickly. We couldn't get it to grow, and finally gave up on it. It was just basically almost dead, and I was ready to throw it out and in the trash. And as usual, I never give up on plants. I said, you know what? I'm going to try to revive this orange tree. I can't give up on it. That's not right. You know, I invited it into my life, and, you know, here, and it deserves better. Let me see what I can do. So I moved it, put it in a different location, fertilized it, started giving it water. So, you know what? It came back to life. It came back to life. Now, then recently, the irrigation got shut off. I didn't know about it all winter. I wasn't thinking about it in the wintertime. And this tree basically almost died again. Almost died again. Actually, the water was shut off, but the drip system to it was blocked somehow. It wasn't getting any water. And all the leaves fell off. It lost almost all its leaves. And a lot of the branches were dead. And I said, wow, I don't know. Is it going to survive or not? And I said, you know, I'm not going to let it die. So again, I just laid all the fertilizer on it and laid, you know, drips, got the drip system working again. And we throw the gray water on it, you know, from the shower. And so it's bursting with new leaves now. It's just bursting back to life and oranges and stuff. And it's beautiful. It's beautiful. So no matter how, I'm getting dive bombed by this bug. No matter how dead you may seem, like you may think that your plant is dead, okay, your life plant is dead, you as a plant are dead, you're not dead, you just haven't been getting the fertilizer and the water and the light that you need. And we're not giving up on you. So you have to understand that somebody is not giving up on you. This is important to realize, that you're not being given up on. I guarantee you that Jesus is not giving up on you. Neither is Longchenpa, neither is Ramana Maharshi, etc. Okay? And you are not being given up on by the Holy Spirit. You're not being given up on by the grace of God. You're not being given up on by God. Okay? They're absolutely not giving up on you. 100% still completely focused on, yes, you can revive and own your spirituality and embrace the spiritual truth within. You can embrace it, and you can say, yes, I am that perfect unfairness. Absolutely, I am that, and I'm happy to be that, and I love being that. I love being that perfect unfairness. Yes, I cannot change what I am at all. How unfair is that? It's perfectly unfair, isn't it? To any idea of wanting to change what I am. Yeah, but I love being unfair to any idea of changing what I am, because I love what I truly am, you see. So, you can come back and blossom, you know, grow and have the spiritual fruit. You absolutely can. But you have to get the buzz going in your mind somehow. And you have to feel, hey, there's a higher authority than cosmic corporate culture. There's a higher authority. There's a higher authority. Now, people are talking about, well, the Messiah, the Savior's within us. Of course it is. But we're so intimidated. We think it's so wrong. It's so unfair to deluge, to arrogance. It's so unfair. Truth is so unfair to arrogance that we don't access it. We don't water it. We don't fertilize it. And so it's super helpful to have an expression of that we can hear and see, and remind us that yes, we do have the truth within us. So the inner Savior is within everyone, but external saviors are very important. They're important reminders that we are the sovereign, the dream, that we are the saviors of the world. Each one of us are the saviors of the universe, actually. It's important to be reminded, because we're paralyzed. We feel we can't own it. So this is the trouble. You get people saying, religion, this, that, you know, that's not true. We just got to all do it ourselves. Well, you know, that's saying, well, we're all paralyzed. We can't do it, but there's nothing we can do about it. That's nonsense. That's absolute nonsense. There can be these savior-like figures. There can be this attitude, those that are just like, wow, this is an amazing attitude, you know, they have. And this is sort of revitalizing my, you know, my spirit. It's revitalizing my spirit. And even the skirts can't put me down anymore, you know. Even the lipstick culture cannot bury me anymore. Wow. How cool is that? I mean, I remember back when that you couldn't be buried, you know, at all by lipstick culture. You could, you know, not why I would say to a certain extent, you could still be buried, believe me. but not as much so. There were some checks and balances, believe it or not, in the past, where you could express and criticize some that which is trying to control you and control your spirituality, and they couldn't necessarily get you thrown in jail for it, you know. They could try, but it wasn't so easy as it is now. I mean, right now, all they have to do is raise an eyebrow, and the gendarmes come running in, and lock you up and throw away the key. You know, just arch a little eyebrow. Ah. It's like eating their food, you know. No, you won't do it. You know. Praetorian guard jumps on you. it says, you will never, ever see the light of day again. I say, well, you know, you got a problem, because I'm perfectly unfair about everything. You see, I am that perfect unfairness. So I can't be unfair. I can't be fair to you in that way at all, actually, because I am that perfect unfairness. And, you know, I'm that perfect failure. So I can't help but fail to follow your demands and instructions and all this kind of stuff. I'm that perfect failure. Absolutely, I am. There's nothing I can do about it. See? nothing I can do about it. I'm that perfect failure. I'm that perfect incompetent. You know, I'm not competent to do what you tell me to do. I'm that perfect incompetence. I'm absolutely that perfect incompetence. I'm that perfect darkness. You know, I can't see what you're saying at all. I can't see what you're telling me to do at all. I'm in the dark about what you're telling me. I'm that perfect darkness. Yes, I am. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Okay? Yes, I am that perfect darkness. So, this is, I love this video. Love talking like that. I mean, this is the kind of talk that I've always wanted to hear. It's like a musician. You have something in your mind, like there's this music you want to hear, and you say, you know, I may have to do it myself because no one's playing exactly the way I want to hear it. So you go into music and you try to produce exactly the songs exactly what you want to hear. This is a strong driving force. So for me, it's spirituality. I wanted to hear something, and I just wasn't hearing it from the world. I just wasn't hearing it. So I said, you know what? I'm going to have to say it. I'm going to have to say it so I can hear it for myself. So I'm saying what I want to hear. I'm saying what I want to hear. Yes, I am that perfect incompetence. Yes, I am that perfect darkness. Yes, I am that perfect failure. Yes, I am that perfect unfairness. You know, I'm that perfect. I can't go along with that because I'm perfectly unfair. I'm absolutely perfect forever and ever and ever, you know. Forever and ever and ever. I'm perfectly stupid. I can't understand anything you're telling me. Yeah, I am that perfect idiot. Absolutely. I am that perfect idiot. I am that perfect idiot. Absolutely I am. Absolutely I am. Absolutely I am. I am. I am. And so hopefully those of you who are listening to this and hearing this and experiencing it are saying like, hey, you know, maybe you're getting it. Saying, "Oh, wait a minute, this is pretty interesting. This is interesting. This is interesting. Wow, you know, I can be that. Absolutely, no, I am that. Right now, I am that. I am that." and then send all complaints to the boss. The boss loves to hear complaints about us. Loves it. Says, "Oh, you mean they're doing my work that I told them to do here? Wonderful! Thanks for telling me. Thanks for telling me, guys. I'm so pleased you came and told me. Now, hopefully, you'll have many more complaints to give me in the future too. Keep the complaints coming. I just can't wait for your next complaint. And that they're doing what I told them to do. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? Absolutely, it is. So." Yes, I am that perfect idiot. You better believe it. You had better believe it. I am that perfect idiot. You're an idiot. Absolutely. But no, I am that. No, no, no. I am that perfect idiot. I truly am that perfect idiot. Anything other than that, I will not accept. No, I am that perfect idiot. Intractable. I am that perfect intractability. I am that perfect stupidity. I am that perfect failure. Yes, 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 I am. So this really unfreezes us. It unfreezes us from cosmic corporate culture and the massive guilt trip they're putting everybody on. I mean, nobody can go through the political process unless they're little robotic clones basically saying what cosmic corporate culture wants them to say right now. Otherwise, the gendarmes will come very quickly for them and pull the plug on them. And so, but again, they're trying to get their power, their authority from people. Okay, don't search for authority from people. Search for authority from your own truth within, and search for authority from Jesus or your tradition, whoever is the boss in your tradition. Okay. Samanta Bhadra or something, Parabrahma, whatever you want to say, however you want to say it is okay, but go for that authority. Hey, you know, the truth is the authority. How God created me is the authority. That's the ultimate truth. How God created us, that is the ultimate authority of my being. How God created us is the ultimate authority of my being, and there is no other authority. There is no authority. So yeah, I am that perfect discrimination. I am, absolutely. I'm a perfect discriminator. I am that perfect discrimination. Hallelujah. Praise be to God. I am that perfect discrimination. So turn around the ego's attacks on you and own them to the total extent. Yeah, I am that perfect bigot. Absolutely, I am that perfect bigot because I only accept what I am as God created me. I accept nothing other than that. So I'm a perfect bigot. I am that perfect bigot. Okay, perfect bigot. 100% perfect. Yes, yes, yes. So you see how the intimidation is like falling away. It's like, wow. Wow, wow, wow. I'm experiencing now out in society and moving around in culture. There are times where the intimidation is dropping away. And I just like, wow. You know, I can't be pushed around anymore. Which is a feeling that I haven't felt, you know, since I was a kid. I say, is this possible? Is this really happening? I say, I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it. I'm feeling it. Wow. Yeah. If I'm driving that car, like a dream car, you know, people are going to say, what? Wow. Who is that? What is that? Whoa. What is that? Where did that come from? You know, it's just like, yeah. And I'll talk, 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 talk. But I give permission to be quiet. The best way is to be quiet. Just be, go quiet. Just go quiet. When you see that car, you just go quiet. Because you're just saying, hallelujah. Any words are damning with faint praise what you're feeling. This is very true. You must be very careful with words. Any praise is really damning the feeling you're having with faint praise. It's a damnation through faint praise. It's better to go quiet. And show yourself you can go quiet. Any expression, any even artistic expression, is damnation through faint praise. Very much damnation through faint praise. Don't try to put it into any format whatsoever. Don't try and put it in any format whatsoever. There's a pragmatic situation with those who are in helping encourage, okay, but it still stands. Don't try to put it in any format whatsoever. Don't try to put it in art. Don't try to write about it. Don't try to talk about it. Just full stop in the wow. Just be quiet about it. Be still about it. Be quiet about it. Don't try to express it. Because that is severe damnation through incredibly faint praise, no matter what you do. We're talking about your being. We're talking about your freedom. We're talking about your identity. I am that. I am that which God created me. I am not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And there's no definition of that whatsoever. I am perfect freedom, has no definition. I am that which is undefinable. I don't know if you say undefinable or indefinable. Maybe you can say both. But either way you say it, I am that. I am that. And don't get caught up in thinking that you need to express it. Because any clarification of it is, again, faint praise. You say, well, how do you spell? Is it undefinable or indefinable? Any attempt to clarify it is itself severe damnation through faint praise. Any effort you make to clarify your being is damnation through faint praise, which is why what we try to do is we try to get to the wow of it. Okay. And of course there's a pragmatism to what we're doing, which is perfectly just and perfectly right. But there's also an awareness that ultimately any attempt to clarify what is already clear only obscures it. Only obscures it. So ultimately, we practice more and more and more and more not expressing it. Just full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. And what I'm doing here is I'm giving assertions. I'm giving attitude, you know, which is good. That's helpful. Giving a lot of attitude. A lot of encouragement. A lot of attitude. And you're hearing that and say, yeah, just be quiet. Don't try to express it. Don't try to express the wow. Don't try to clarify the clarity. Don't try to clarify the clarity. And the biggest wow of all is here we are in the end times where the universe is trying to knock us out, trying to knock everybody out. Knock the stuffings out of us. And here we are. We're defeating it. We're overcoming it. We're being liberated from it. You know, instead of being crushed, we're expanding and we're elated, you know, and we got attitude now. We got attitude. See, yeah, I got attitude. I got perfect attitude, actually. I am that perfect attitude. I am that perfect attitude. Absolutely, I have attitude. I am that perfect attitude. And this is just super wow. Because the cosmic corporate culture totally believes that it's going to crush every single one of us, you see. And we're just like saying, wow, it's not crushing me. This is just like, wow. And then don't define it. Don't define it. This is why I use this term, wow, to help everyone. This is sort of a non-definitional expression. It seems like a word, but it's just wow. It's just like, wow, man. It's just wow. You know, it's just, we use that a lot. And I could say, oh, yeah, it's just like, you know, wow. It was okay. We didn't have to express what it was. We didn't have to define it. It's just like, wow, man. Yeah, let me just be quiet. It's like you're standing on a cliff overlooking the Pacific Ocean, looking at the surf, and there's these sets rolling in, and the sun is hitting the water. It's just like so beautiful. I mean, you can't express it. And you know, it's early in the morning, and crisp California, beautiful California morning, and the ocean is so glassy smooth, and the waves are going. It's just like you're standing there, and you come up, somebody's looking, and you just like come up, and you just stand next to them and just look out there, and you don't say anything to them. And if you look at each other and just like smile and just like say, oh, what? It's like, wow, man. Wow. They say, yeah, wow. That's it. And they're just quiet. Don't have to say anything. Don't have to say anything. Anything you say is damning with faint praise, right? So you don't get real chatty, chatty, chatty. Just be quiet. We don't need Chatty Cathy with us at all times, you know? The little robotic doll, you just tick, 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 tick. Or Hello Kitty or whatever they got, you know. Just, we don't just be just we just need the wow, that's all. I got the wow doll with me. What does the wow doll do? They say, oh really, you got this really cool invention. You invented the wow doll. Yeah, I invented the wow doll. What does the wow doll do? Well, it's the most amazing doll there's ever been. Really? Yes. Yes. People just love it. Well, what can it do? It says absolutely nothing. Doesn't say a word. Doesn't say a word. Or maybe it just says, wow. That's all it says. It's the wow doll. Just wow. Nothing more. Hey, doll, what do you have to say? Wow. Oh, yeah. Wow. So maybe we should all get wow dolls. Wow dolls by Whammo or something like that, or Mattel or something. Maybe you can market that to Mattel. The wow doll. The silent doll, you press the button, the talking, just like nothing, nothing. Oh, great. The doll, the doll with no batteries, the battery free doll doesn't say anything. Just silence is out. Great. And we want to, the greatest thing is give each other permission to be quiet. See, this is what we're missing here in this world right now. It used to be, you felt like it was okay to be quiet. You had permission to be quiet. You didn't have to say anything. Because we weren't so frantically pursuing the objectives of cosmic corporate culture. We're so frantically doing that. Now, I know there's been some people, some hippies, some people tried to just keep that lifestyle going. I have great admiration for them. But, you know, you have to work at it with great discipline. And the cosmic corporate culture is more intense than we realize. They co-opt everything. They co-opt everything. And they make it so that you have to have so much money just to survive now. You have to buy into to the whole thing, you know, or buy into the government on welfare, etc. And ultimately, you slide down, you become oppressed, and you become so, you know, it's just brutal. It's brutal here, and yet we can have the attitude. So yeah, I got that perfect attitude. I have that perfect attitude. I am that perfect attitude. I am that perfect attitude. Now I'm going late here. It's past midnight. And because I got to rest this afternoon, I wasn't able to sleep last night. I was hit so hard by all this, and I realized the pressure is on so intense right now. And I got to get going. I absolutely have to get going. Time is running out on us all. I mean, Puerto Rico, I just, found out today, they have $73 billion in debt. They can't pay it back. I mean, Greece is like $1.5 billion in debt to the European Union. They're defaulting, and they get kicked out of the Euro, European Union, EU. $1.5 billion. But, of course, the overall debt is, they just can't make the interest, the debt payment on it. They can't make the payment on their debt. I think where Puerto Rico is just like $73 billion in debt, and they cannot, they can't make the payments on it. So, you have these countries, and then like,